In 1911, a team of archaeologists were excavating 5,000-year-old tombs near the village of Gerza, about 60 kilometers south of Cairo. Of the 280 graves in the cemetery, tomb 67 contained the most remarkable finds, 9 iron beads.
Here we are, case B, in the main gallery.
This is Alice Stevenson, curator of the Petrie Museum.
The Petrie has several things from tomb 67, including the 3 iron beads, which are here. One was found at the neck, and a couple of beads were found at the waist, and I think there were one or two beads just scattered nearby. So whether these are parts of clothing, whether these are bracelets, necklets, anklets, perhaps an anklet, is sometimes not always clear.
The pre-dynastic tomb predates the Iron Age by 2,000 years, making these some of the oldest forged iron artifacts in the world. But the source of the iron, and how the beads were made, remained uncertain since the beads were discovered in 1911.
Obviously, people have been looking at this for 100 years, ever since these early beads were found. And people generally agree that it's most likely that they're made from meteoritic iron, from metal that fell from the sky, which is a term that actually the ancient Egyptians already used.
This is UCL archaeologist Professor Thilo Rerin on the phone from Qatar. He, along with colleagues Albert Jambon from France and a team from Hungary, has led a new study investigating once and for all the composition of these beads.
We know that meteoritic iron typically has a few percent, 5 to 10% nickel in it, a bit like modern stainless steel. What we needed to do is to test really for more exotic trace elements, and there's one in particular called germanium, and that we were able, thanks to the collaboration with a very strong research team in Budapest in Hungary, to finally detect these very, very, very small quantities of germanium that are trapped in the metal and which only occur in meteoritic iron, but not in iron that has been made on Earth.
When they were found, they were already very, very corroded. And that's why Thilo's research has been so important, because to actually get an understanding of material composition, you've got to go to the core. And these are not artifacts we want to be subjected to destructive analysis. So the kinds of approach that he's taken allows us to say an awful lot from what are very old, corroded little beads.
Because of the imaging that they were able to do, what we were able to physically see is how these beads were made, and that tells us that already in this very early period, the metalsmith had this expertise and the skill to do that with the very hard, brittle, difficult to work meteoritic iron. And that is a really exciting part of the research here.
It wasn't for another 2 millennia, around 1200 BC, that metal workers in the region began smelting iron and producing iron from iron ore. This study demonstrates that metal workers already had nearly 2,000 years of experience in working with meteoritic iron when the Iron Age began.
The iron beads were found along with lapis lazuli from Afghanistan, gold foil beads, carnelian from the eastern desert. It's a really eclectic range of materials that are being brought together to form their personal ornamentation.
So do we know, or do we have any indication then of who was buried with this?
In terms of sex, I don't think we can say. But there was one individual, and that individual didn't just have these special beads. That individual also had several other unusual things that we don't see in any other grave in the cemetery, including the only copper harpoon, the only miniature ivory vessel. So whoever was buried with these beads seems to have been recognized as having some kind of importance that meant that they could have access to these unusual things.
It's not just with the Petrie collection, it's in all the collections, there's a lot still to be discovered and to be analyzed and studied. It's always good for archaeologists to excavate. That is very exciting, but then they excavate so much material, we hardly manage to catch up with studying all of that excavated material. And it is really in the detailed, tiny bits and pieces analysis that even decades after excavations, we still learn a lot more about past societies, about how and why people did change their environment, arrange their lives, and so on. So yes, there's a lot more to come.